Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Glad to welcome you this morning to Hanfield Global Methodist Church. Good to be gathered with you this morning in the house of the Lord. As we begin this morning, just a few announcements. First of all, we are beginning a new sermon series today called Family Reunion, based on the book of, primarily of Genesis and really Abraham's family. That's what we'll after today. But if there's new study guide, daily reading books out in the lobby, it's got a green cover. It looks like this. Many of our ABFs are going through this, so make it one if you're one of those ABFs. Even if your ABF is not going through it and you want to read through it on your own, you're welcome to take one. I urge you to do that. Also, in our newsletter, there's actually something that was incorrect in our newsletter, and I have no one to blame but myself. I was going to Diane, then I looked at email and realized that it was my fault, not hers. So I can't do that. But our senior recognition Sunday will be Sunday, June 18th. It's the 13th in the newsletter. The 13th is not a Sunday. I don't know what I was thinking. So anyway, that'll be 2 weeks from today. Will be our senior recognition Sunday. So if you have graduated or are graduating from high school or even college and have graduated at any time during the 22-23 academic year, if you graduated back in December from college or if your child did and you want them to be recognized, that's okay. As well, we do that. So there's some information that I'll need for that Sunday. That's on the screen and in our newsletter. Information didn't change. So if you could get that to me, that would be much appreciated. We can celebrate and recognize our seniors on the Youth Sunday. Also, next week on June 12th starts Fairmount Teen Camp, the 12th through 16th. And it's still not too late to register for that. That's, again, in the newsletter. What'll happen and what goes on. So I know many of our youth have already registered for that, but RAPA registration is still open. And if you have any questions about Fairmount Teen Camp, you come and see me. But I encourage you and sign up your child if they have completed 6th grade through 12th grade to be able to go to Fairmount Camp. As we begin this morning, would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for today. It's good to be gathered in your house and with you, so we are thankful for that. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would come and fill this place, fill our hearts, and fill our lives today. May you come and work and move in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Well, good morning. We serve an awesome and mighty God who has his own even family relationship with himself in a way to describe it. And here we find ourselves on Trinity Sunday, celebrating God and his familiar terms, his family terms in and amongst himself. And that's a pretty amazing thing that I don't think we can understand. And yet he lets us in sometimes too. He goes up and there's the angelic beings of fire that Abraham gets to host. And he gets to talk to himself in family relationship in front of Abraham. There's no other way to describe except the fact that it almost beyond our understanding until he opens up and shares it with us. So I want you to just and sing about how awesome it is that God's letting us in on the family conversation today. Would you stand and sing together?
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and our heart strives to hide. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great. Age to age, he stands. died upon the cross. You are my Jesus who loves me. You poured out all your blood. You died upon the cross. You are my Jesus who loves me. Oh, you are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. Oh, you are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I will sing again. Oh, I will sing again. You are my Father in heaven. Jesus who loves me.
The Holy Spirit, thank you. It's the Holy Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will once again will raise you from the dead. Praise Jesus. Love him.
We give you thanks this morning that you have sent your Spirit. We give you thanks this morning, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. For you are good. We give you thanks for who you are. You have adopted us into your family. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. And as we do here at Hanfield, if there's a special request that is on your heart, or if you would like to intercede on behalf of someone else, we would ask that you stand where you are, and those around you can lay a hand on your shoulder, and the rest of us will stretch our arms out towards you as we gather with you in prayer. So this morning, if you ever have a request, would like to intercede on behalf of someone else, would you stand? Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks. Your Spirit is present and here with us today. Lord, we come before you and we proclaim how great you are. Great is our God, and Lord. We are so thankful for you and your greatness. That you are the creator, that you are the redeemer and the sustainer. You lift us up. You give us strength. You give us perseverance. Lord, I give you thanks for that. I pray that you could be with anyone here who may need things today, who may need a touch from you and your grace. For some extra strength, even now. Lord, we come for you to lift up those who are standing. You know the request that is on their heart. You know, Lord, what it is that has brought them to their feet today, and we trust and believe that you are already at work in this situation. Lord, we trust and believe you're already at work. So we pray that you could be with those that have stood and what is on their heart, and we that you know, and we give you thanks for that. That is comforting to us that even without vocalizing our request, you already know what's on earth. So Lord, we thank you. We pray that you would send your peace to surpass all understanding to those that have stood today. May you be with them. May you be leading and guiding and answering their prayers. And most of all, we pray that your will would be done. Lord, so pray today for our pastor. We pray that you could be with Chris and his family as he's on sabbatical. We pray that you would be with them in their troubles, that you would provide safety wherever they may be, what they may be doing, Lord, wherever they're going, that you would be with him, that you would guide his family and him and keep them safe. And we pray that this would be a time of rest and renation from him and him. And we, Lord, that your Spirit would be with him right now and his family. That this may be a time that they grow closer together and also closer to you, and we pray that you would give him what he needs. We also today, Lord, for Steve Law, we give you thanks for him and willingness to come and share your word with us during time. Over these next several weeks, we would be with him and fill him with your word as he comes to deliver a message that I know is from you today. Lord, may we hear you as you speak through him. We also lift before you our graduates. There are a couple of graduations today that are happening in some of our districts locally, and one that happened on Friday. Lord, we could be with those that have graduated. You would be with their family and pray your blessing upon them where they go. And in the next chapter of life, may you be leading and guiding and directing them, we pray. Lord, this morning we indeed come to say how great you are because you are great. So we sang that already. We proclaim it now. How great are God. Father, we thank you this morning that you have sent your Son. Jesus, we thank you that you have sacrificed yourself for us so that we may live. And that you have sent your Spirit. So Holy Spirit, we're thankful for you and that you can indwell within us. We pray as we start this Genesis sermon series, started by looking at the Trinity, Lord, that we would look to in the example that you have set in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit of how relations should be. Lord, that you have given an example, and may we look to that first family relationship. We give you thanks for the Father and for the Son and for the Spirit of adoption who adopts us into your family. And Lord, I pray today, if no one has experienced that adoption into the family of God, that to be the day that they would experience. We give you thanks, Lord, that you are here. We give you thanks for this time gathered together. Holy Spirit, we pray that you come and open our eyes that we may see from you. That you would open ears that we may hear from you. That you would open our hearts and minds to understand from you. May we turn to you and be healed. We pray all this in the name of Jesus who taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May you be seated. This time, our children are dismissed to Sunka Half Ministry. Miss Shirley is waiting in the back by the double doors for you. So our children are dismissed for their time together. We will say a prayer over them and also a prayer for the tithes and offerings have been or will be collected. Lord, we thank you for these children this morning. We know that they are a blessing from you. We praise you to be with them during their time together, that they would grow closer to you. Lord, be with them during this time of discipleship and be with those leading them as well. We also give you thanks for this opportunity to give back to you as already yours. So pray that you could bless both gift and giver this morning, and that we would be good stewards with what we receive in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand again. In your name.
Me in prayer. God, for the assurance of salvation that you give to those who love you, who call upon the name of Jesus. And so we come for you in Jesus' name. In the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. We come before in Jesus' name by his merits, by his spirit. We pray that you would speak to us this morning. Make your word come alive in our hearts. May we serve you with openness and love. And people of God said, amen. You may be seated. The first time I speak to a group of people, always a little bit jittery. So I won't hold up my hand lest you see how much shaking. I'm going to be reading from Genesis chapter 1, starting with verse 1. And so, if you have your Bibles, I encourage you to turn to that. Or if you have your device, you have Bible on your device, you can take a phone. You might put it on hand, though, so that it doesn't ring in the middle of the service. Reading from Genesis chapter 1, beginning with verse 1, reading verse 5 verses, and we'll drop down and read a little bit more a little later in the chapter. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The earth was formless and void, and darkness over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light. God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and then there was morning, day. Now, for those of you who have your Bibles, if you'll go ahead and glance down and look down a little bit farther, that was the first day where God created light. So what did God create on the second day? Anybody remember that from Bible school or from some other? What did God create on the second day? What did I hear? The heavens? Yeah, the heavens first. Second day, third day, the earth and the plants. Fourth day, the sun, moon, and stars. Fifth day, the fish and the birds. Obviously, I have not memorized them because I'm reading them. The sixth day, land, animals, and people. So now we're going to come to that point where God creates humans. And so if you'll look down on verse 26, Genesis chapter 1, starting with verse 26. Then God said, Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. And let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. God created man in his own image. In the image of God created him, male and female, he created them. God blessed them. God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky, over every living thing that moves on the earth. Then God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the surface of the earth, and every tree that has fruit yielding seed, it shall be food for you. And to every beast of the sky, and to every bird of the sky, and to every and to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the sky, and to everything that moves on the earth, which has life, I have given every green plant food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made. Behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our God abides forever. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. I think it's a great day to start a sermon on a series of family. But before I go there, it's a good day to be home. I'm just glad to be home. We've been away. I preached twice in the first church that we served. April, I preached twice there, and then in May, I preached two Sundays there. And so we've been away some, and it's good to be back in our home church. It is home. It feels like home. We really appreciate the people at Hanfield this morning, Hanfield. Maybe before I get down to where I was thinking about some of that, maybe just a real or two to just kind of start our minds thinking. What do you think? Just a real or two about family or some kind of family relationships or something like that. What did the daddy say, that dead buffalo say to the son buffalo as the son went off for school? Oh, you knew that one. You probably know all these. Bison. Bison, get it? Bison. Yeah, you know one. One more. What did the money bullet say to the day bullet? We're going to have a BBB. Now, if you laugh, that's good, really, but most of the time people moan at those things. So if you feel that need to moan, go ahead and let it out, you know it. It's cathartic. It helps you to shoot it. You know, it's healing in a way. Oh, Sunday was Pentecost Sunday. I missed being here for a number of reasons. One was the church that we worshiped at did not celebrate Pentecost Sunday. I love Pentecost Sunday. I mean, it's right there at the top. Easter. Christmas and Pentecost for me are real close second place. I mean, I love Pentecost. But they didn't acknowledge Pentecost Sunday either in the mornings or the evenings. So I was a little bit disappointed, but it was their tradition. Today is Trinity Sunday. So last Sunday you focused on the coming of the Holy Spirit, filling the empowering, indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. And today, take that a step farther, it was designated, Trinity Sunday was designated to emphasize and celebrate the three-in-one nature of God. As Brett was saying earlier, it's a mystery. We can understand it, and we can explain it. I watched a video in preparation earlier this week, and it was kind it was sarcastic in a way, because everything we tried to do to explain the Trinity, if we some symbol, it misses it, and it really enforces one of the heresies that have gone before us. And so there's no other way to explain it than just say three in one. There are creeds that we just affirm with the creed, and it's there. But it's such a ministry. So today we emphasize Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And it's a great to begin a series of sermons on the family, don't you think? Trinity Sunday, a great day to do family. What does Trinity have to do with family? Well, those of you who have time in ABFs or have used the green book that Derek mentioned a little bit ago will know where we're headed here. The Trinity, that communion, God Father, God the Son, God, Holy Spirit, is central to family. So today we start where God established the covenant of marriage and the family unit. With the beginning of the family, to go to the beginning of the family, we need to go back to Genesis. Genesis chapter 2 talks about it in detail. Genesis of the man and the woman and being placed in the garden. Genesis chapter 1, though, gives us that first glimpse into the creation. So I want to go to Genesis chapter with a focus verse for us. Even though we learn more about family in Genesis chapter 2 and about relationships and about fall, Pastor Curtis and I agreed that the creation of family finds its roots in the early verse of Genesis. So let's start with verse 26. That's the theme verse for today. Verse 26, Genesis chapter 1. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image according to our likeness." Our. Let us. Who is God talking to? Let us make man in our image. Well, there have been a number of different kind of explanations or interpretations. Some have said things like, well, this is written back when there were still influences of other religions, and so other religions had multiple gods, and so the creator God was saying to the council of the gods, let us make man in our image. I don't think it's true with the full revelation of God's word. I don't think it's a couple of reasons. It doesn't true with the full counsel of God's word. First, God would not reveal something that's untrue to be placed in Holy Scriptures. There is no council of the gods, there is God. So God is God and there is no other. There is no council of the gods. God would not reveal something to be included in his word that was not true. Second, it doesn't ring true the rest of what happens there. If God was talking to the council of the gods and let us make man in our image, our likeness, and that they weren't involved in any creation, it doesn't make sense. God says, let us do it, and then they don't have any part in it. It just does sense. It doesn't follow good logic. Another way it's been explained, it was God talking to the angels, us. Well, again, then they weren't involved in it. There is no account where the angels had any part in creation. So the full counsel of God's word reveals some more with the benefit of that full counsel, including the New Testament. We understand us to be the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. The full accounts of God's word reveals how all persons of the Trinity were involved in creating. And we usually think of God the Father as creator. God the Son, God the Holy Spirit involved in creation as well, in creating. Derek did a great job. By the way, the green book that he referred to, guess who wrote that? Derek. Puts that together all the time, he just did a wonderful job. He did a great job listing about a dozen or so different places where the scripture refers to fullness of the Trinity being involved in creation, in creating. I'm not going to highlight all 12 of those. Somebody thank you, Jesus. but there are a lot of them that I would like to highlight. The evidence of the Holy Spirit being involved in creation is directly referred to. This is chapter 1, verse 2. The earth formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering, brooding moving the surface of the waters. God, the Holy Spirit, was involved in creation. And so John also writes about how Jesus was present and active in creating the world. At the beginning of the gospel, John writes these words, and he refers to Jesus as the Word. Those of you who are familiar with this will recognize that. And if you're not, hang in there, and we'll explain it just a little bit. In the beginning was the Word, and that's referring to Jesus. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. That is a powerful statement. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. When God said, let there be light, his word was Jesus. In the beginning was the Word. And Jesus was involved in creation. The fullness of the Trinity. Let us create. Now we could even put Jesus in wherever the word is referred to. And let's do that. So leaving that scripture verse up there, John chapter 1, verses 1. And I'll substitute the name Jesus in there. The beginning was Jesus. Jesus was with God, and Jesus was God. Jesus was in the beginning with God. All things came to being through Jesus. Apart from Jesus, nothing came to being that has come to being. Jesus was involved in creation, the fullness of the Trinity. All members of the Trinity were present and active in creating. That's why God said, let us. Man in our age. There is another Trinity type word in the first of Genesis. Genesis chapter 1 says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There is a Trinity type word in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, and it is the Hebrew word for God, Elohim. Elohim. Say that. Elohim. Elohim is a plural word. The I am on the ending of it is like what we do with or ES on the ends of words that make plural. God or gods. Elohim is the Hebrew word for God, and it's a plural word. So sometime the Bible and in the Old Testament's referring to the gods of the nations, they'll say Elohim and pronounce it gods. But whenever Hebrews refer to God, it is never gods, even though it's a plural word, it is always God. God is one. Of all the things that the Jewish people affirm, first of all in their faith, there is God. God is one. But this word, this plural word, is there. Elohim refers to the Trinity. What does this have to do with family? Are you with me? We're getting there. Let us in, or the us in let us or create refers to the Trinity. The Hebrew word for God, Elohim, refers to the Trinity. The Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, is the perfect family. If you would have been able to notice first of all, when we would start talking about the title of the sermon, The Perfect Family, you might have thought that it was talking about Adam and Eve. But not. It's talking about the Trinity, God, in perfect communion. So, if we want to learn about family relationships and grow our family relations, I think we would do well to study what God revealed in His Word about relationships between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And one of the first things we learn from the Trinity is that God is relational. God is relational. Before becoming a pastor, I was involved in a discipleship group, of men, five of us that met together every Monday. And we met together to challenge and encourage one another, especially in classic Christian disciplines, studying scripture, prayer, fasting, and others. The way we got started in that was we went to Nicholasville, Kentucky, down by a neighboring town close to where Asbury is, and a man by the name of Paul Law force-fed us, I mean, not force-fed us, but spoon-fed us, some of the lodge of covenant discipleship. What the Bible has to say about being in discipleship relationships. And one of the first truth he affirmed was that God is relational. God relates with himself in the Trinity in perfect harmony. And that God relates with people in perfect harmony, at least at the beginning. God is relational. God is relational in nature. Trinity teaches that God is relational in nature. The Hebrew word for God teaches us that God is relational in nature. And so at the very core, God's being is his relational nature. And God is relational in nature. And we are created in the image of God. And we are created as relational beings. We need relationships. We cannot exist on our own. We need one another. And for good or for bad, we learn in large part from parents' impact upon us about relationships. Now, this morning, when we got into the car, which is not our car is in the shop, and they gave us a loaner. It is sweet loaner. It's a 2020. It's a nice car. It's a green. It's out. I'll wait when we leave. Okay. We got in, and my wife, sitting right over there, got in, and when she was moving her foot over, she kicked the underneath part of the I don't know if it's the heater housing or, right under your feet go. And she said, "Oh, sorry." And I said, "Car kicker." I have a tendency to do that. So if somebody does something, I call them whatever they just did. Well, we watch some of our grandsons. We have the blessing of being close enough now to watch some be closer into involvement in the life of our some of our grandsons. On Wednesdays, we go down to Muncie and we'll be during the summer watching all three of Jeremy, our youngest son's kid. And yesterday Andrew and I went down. And we helped Jeremy deal with some brush and stuff. He had needed to got this big chipper thing, that's sweet, kind of thing, So we're down there helping him, and we go in and to take a break, sweat pouring off of us, and sit and cool off a little bit, and some water, and Jeremy goes over, and Casey had warmed some pizza, and then Jeremy gets a bite of pizza, and he takes a bite, and I came in there and said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm eating some pizza." Brody, their second oldest son, says, "Pizza eater." He'd been around Grandpa too long. We learn things from our parents and grandparents, do we not? For good or for ill, we learn things. So the seeds that we plant, maybe some of those seeds, weeds, we'll pray for crop failure. Amen? I didn't hear much amen, but it's the truth. Because we also relate with others as a result of something else that our parents passed on to us, and that was the sinful nature. Our parents passed on to us our sinful nature. Sin impacts relationships. We see it from the moment that sin entered the Garden of Eden. Sin obviously impacts our relationship with God. Adam hid from God. They no longer were in that picture. Communion with God. They were separated from God. Sin impacts relationships with one another. Think back of what happened when sin entered the world, when Adam and Eve sinned. They not only hid themselves from God, hid themselves from one another. They realized they were naked and they sewed leaves together to conceal themselves from one another. Sin impacts relationships with one another. When God said, "Where are you?" and Adam said, "Well, we hid." He said, "Why did you eat of the fruit?" What was his response? "Oh, yes, I did. Forgive me, God." "No," he said, "the woman you gave me, she ate, and then I did." The woman. He passed the buck. He blamed it on her. And not only did he blame her, he blamed it on God. "The woman you gave me." Oof. Another way that our relationship with God, the impact that sin had on it. In the process of blaming the woman, Adam also blamed God. Sin impacts our relationships with the created order, the creation around us. God said, "Cursed is the ground because of you. Thorn thistles it shall grow. By the sweat of your face you will bread." How many of you here know that sin creates broken relationships? Maybe one step in dealing with that is to own it. Not pass the buck. To own it. Sometimes it takes me far too long, but When I part with Andrea, eventually, by God's grace, I finally get to the place where I not only apologize to her, but apologize to God and own it. I was wrong. I think that's a part of restoring relationships. Owning it. Confessing it. And then letting it go. Not holding on to it. But we confess it before God and before family. Because as I asked how many of you know sin breaks relationships, how many of you this morning here know that God can free us from sin and restore broken relationships? Amen? Isn't that good news? We can go to the one who restores and redeems. And from that moment on, God began to implement a plan to redeem that which was lost. And God began redemption in a family. Abraham and descendants. Abraham, our father. Now this week, I've been focusing on the early part of Genesis. For the remainder of the series, we'll be looking later in Genesis, and so you'll see that. Those of you who get one of the study journals in Derek's work there, it'll be in the. We'll start pick up with Abraham now, skipping from chapter 1 to about chapter 12. So we'll pick up there and look at those. So I want to be aware of that. So even if you don't use one of those journals, read ahead in the scriptures. Look at what God is doing through Abraham and his family. Notice. And here's something that I think can give us hope. That God used Abraham and his family for something, even though at times relationships were broken and messed up. God began the revelation of that redemption through a family, the descendants of Abraham. That perfect family. And through that family, God gave his only begotten son to redeem and restore us to right relationships with him and relationships with one another. This is not only Tree Sunday, but this is also the first Sunday of the month. And so, on the first Sunday of the month, the tradition here at Hanfield is to celebrate Holy Communion. Holy Communion. Do you hear the words? Holy Communion. Of anything that we might say about perfect family, the Trinity, we can definitely say that they are in complete communion with one another. Amen. Amen. Christ, Lord, invites to his table all who love him and earnestly really repent of their sin and seek to live in peace. And might I also say to live in holy communion with one another. Therefore, let confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. For us, we pray. Free us, joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now let's make our own confession before God, and God highlight to you or lift up to you some ways that family relationships need to be restored. So let's pray. The good news. Christ died for us. We were yet sinners. And that proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right, and a good, joyful thing always and everywhere. Where thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You put us in your image, breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their ending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is it as he comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son. Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach Jesus to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, ate sinners. By the baptism of suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, deliver us from slavery to sin, death, and made with us a new covenant by water, Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to the disciples and said, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup and said, gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you or many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us guests gathered here. And on these gifts, bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to invite those who are coming to assist. We practice open communion. That means you don't need to be a member of this congregation, really any church. If you want to follow Jesus Christ, we invite you to come to his table. This is his table, not mine, not ours. His table, and you're welcome at his table. We'll use intinction, which for the most part is, we'll hand you a piece of bread and you just dip the edge of it into the chalice. If you don't feel comfortable doing that, there is gluten-free, there are gluten-free cups there in the basket, and you're welcome to take one of those and use that instead of the bread. And so you come to do that. The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup for which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. The table is set. You come to come. Shed and free. The blood of Christ shed for you. Thank you, God, for this blessed time with you and with the body of Christ. Bless us, God, to be the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood, broken and poured out for all. Help us to be the body of Christ in the world. And may people come to know Jesus by our witness to his grace. We ask all in his name. Amen. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Awesome God, mighty King, make our lives an offering. Nothing can or ever will come between. Set our eyes on the beauty of your face, O Lord, Father, your glory.